The internet is broken, which is not a very nice message, of course. I think everybody experienced that broken is in the sense of trust, in the sense of that you feel that it's not really doing what it was expected to do, but also really broken in the sense how in 2013 Snowden told us that all kind of vulnerabilities of the internet are being taken advantage of by companies, but also by the CIA and other FBI and so on. So the internet is also spying on us, not just only from the companies, not just only surveillance capitalism, but also from states. And states are spying to each other. So it feels as an uncomfortable sphere, let alone what's happening in the social media and the revelations of Cambridge Analytica about how our elections could be played upon on and how social media is basically profiting from hate and from cultures of denial of democracy. So, but I also say we can fix it. And but this, when I finished the book, I realized I had five ways of what I describe more in detail. In way of fixing it. And the first one, not always is being addressed, is that we have to change the narrative. We are living in a narrative of technocracy, of techno-solutionism, that all our problems will fade away if we have technology. So we need self-driving cars because we humans kill each other. We need learning analytics because we don't know how students learn anymore, because we don't know them, because the scale of educational institutions are too big. We need artificial intelligence to be healthy. So there's all kind of ways that we think that only in technology we will save all our problems. And I would say, well, we don't need artificial intelligence, we have to understand what social intelligence is. So we have to first understand what we are as humans and how we can build upon these social intelligences, and also think about us as entanglements with nature, and that we can't do as if we are, that we just can bring all these artifacts in the world without having any footprint and effects on that. The second one is break up big tech. It's very easy to say, it's very difficult to do it, but I think there's a starting point. There is some willingness, both in politics, as there are some class action suits happening. This is one of the bigger issues. This is really luring up and make the rule of law again back into also the digital domain. And I think it's a little bit happening, especially in Europe, European Commission, coming from different perspectives. Of course, the GDPR, but also different perspectives. So breaking a big tech definitely has to happen. Reclaim economics. We can't just fix the internet if we don't rethink economics. If we think that markets will solve our problems, as most of the social democrats, the liberals, the conservatives still believe, then we will keep on giving our innovation to the markets. And these markets, financial markets and the real economy, are disentangled. So this is not a solution. We can't just continue. And I'm very afraid for the Groeifonds, the investment fund for the Netherlands, that they only think about how companies will have the BV Nederland, the Netherlands as a limited organization, will benefit from innovation where there are no rules for how this kind of knowledge and artificial intelligence and data become commons. Because I think commons should be at the heart of our society, at the center of our society, and not the market. And then, of course, we have to believe in another story about how we have to transform our societies. The internet is in the same desperate state as the planet, in the sense that it's based on extraction and not on regenerative models. So we have to rethink how to come to new ideas, new concepts, and more inclusive design and architecture for our technologies. And I think there's a whole notion about transformative innovation, which means that you're not going into, like, we have key enabling technologies that we're going to pursue, but we have to think about key enabling methodologies, what we want to pursue, which is more design-led and more inclusive. And then, of course, this is all more trying to fix the blueprints, the spreadsheets, the underlying principles of how we think about technology and how we work with technology, but then we also actually have to build it. So we have to build this open digital space, this digital public space, the internet as a commons, and it's possible and doable. Because this, of course, this is an image very recently where they say, please don't blockchain our babies, which I think is quite a funny one, because it actually is happening that people think that we can put our identity on the blockchain, and then when from the early beginnings, you will have your identity and it can be changed. There's all this kind of language and lingo going on in around the internet that I think there's a mystification about what it can do and how it can save, again, some of our topics. So this statement, we do not believe in your technocracy, I think this is definitely something that is we have to be aware of, that at the moment there is a strange connection between people that are afraid for 5G, afraid for COVID, afraid for the mask because there's aluminium inside of the mask, which is connected to 5G, and Bill Gates. And so there's this sort of very strange conspiracy going on where people are trying to figure out what this all means and why we have to believe in technology. So there's also a very backlash of this technocracy and this techno-solutionism. So I'm not here to say that I don't believe in technology, because I do, actually. I think there's a lot of we have a lot to gain from it. So now we experience the technology as a closed black box. It's based big tech in control, extraction of value, surveillance capitalism, the human values and democracies are at stake. This is underneath the surface. So we only see the applications, but this is happening underneath the surface. This gives us this uncomfortable feeling. What we want from the application in the future is that underneath the surface, the technology is open and public, society is in control. It's regenerative in the sense that there's no value extracted. Data minimalization, so not everything what we do is turned into data. And of course, it's a fair and sustainable future. So the problem of this whole idea about fixing the internet and fixing technology and fixing society is most of it is underneath the surface. And a lot of people don't have access to what's happening underneath the surface. Where does it come from? What is actually inside of the black box? So we split it up in some layers. So we have the citizen's perspective. You have the technology stack, which is underneath the applications. There's a design process that makes the technologies. And there is the foundation, the fundament from which people design. A lot of people believe that technology is there and it has to be like this. But technology is not neutral. It's designed. These are human artifacts. So there is power inside of it. So you can say technology is not neutral, but you also can say technology is an expression of power. And so we have to clarify it, we have to demystify that. We can start with the foundation, so the starting point and the worldview that you have. So if you think, if you're a techno-solutionist, or if you feel that humans fail each other, then technology will save us. So this is we have to clarify that a lot of people coming from this idea that we need the internet for all kind of stuff comes from a specific worldview. It's also that they can think about where are we optimizing for? Who defines what the problem is? And why are we going to spend the money to solve that problem? So if you give a billion or a million to the CEO of a company or the shareholders of a company, they will spend this million differently on artificial intelligence than when you give it to the labor union. They will have another option. They want they will solve another problem with it. So spending our money on technology is not neutral, and so we have to clarify who is actually defining where we are spending the money on. The second layer is the fundamental rights and values. So if we don't put them inside of the design process, we can't just add them later on. So I don't believe in all kind of ethic committees that are there to judge the technology when it's already being designed, when it's already being implemented, when on the surface of the application. And I believe really asking philosophers to sit in ethic committees is not the way to go. So ethics is in our in our action. It's in our design process. It's who was on the table. That is ethics. So it's a practical, ethical process. Another question that we have to solve is the social economic considerations. So who owns it? Will it be privatized information? Are we going to put the information and knowledge into a commons or an open source, open hardware? If it's not open, is it still accountable? So this kind of very, very easy questions actually to solve, but not the ones that will be. If you spend your money on closed technology in the hands of private partners, you know you're in trouble in some years. So it's very strange that we spend so much money on those kind of closed technologies. And then, of course, the governance and the supervision. So how are we govern? How are we supervise this whole process? Is it accountable? To whom is it accountable? Who decides upon that? What kind of governance are in place? So again, not at the end, but at the beginning of a process. And then, of course, we come to the design process. And again, ethics is in the design process. So who can participate? Who defines the challenge? Or where are we going to optimize for? Who owns the outcome? This design process at the moment, I think we are divided in betas and alphas. I'm not sure if anybody can identify him or herself with either one of those. I think it's a really strange way to define ourselves and the type of knowledge that we have. So we need much more interdisciplinary processes. We have to have people that have knowledge about real the things that are on the ground, that are in the process of social processes, social innovation, together with people that understanding technologies. And since technology is cultural artifact, we have to see it as a cultural production and not put it aside as something for the techies, that the techies do, and then we from the other part is going to try to figure it out what they did. I think we really have to solve this also in educational institutions, but also in the way that we design the technology. And then we have the stack itself. The stack in itself, when I now open it up, a lot of people get really annoyed because it's very, then they say, oh, all these terms, all these terminologies, I can't really understand it. So some people think it's, the people that understand it think it's too superficial, so because they need more details to discuss it. But I think this is possible to make this more understandable for a lot of people, this layer, this cake of layers that the internet is. So it's not just the application, this is also the hardware. Is the hardware open or not? The operating systems, all that kind of stuff that's beneath the surface. And we just had a very interesting discussion about around the COVID app. We had a very nice public discussion on a protocol, the PEP-PT protocol versus the DP3T protocol, which was centralized data storage or distributed data storage. And I think this was a very interesting way to discuss a protocol because it was clear that it's our political decisions. These are decisions about who is in power, who is in charge. So a distributed data storage on your own phone is really a different proposition than a centralized data storage with a state or a company. So I think it's possible to discuss protocols in a way that people understand that these are normal discussions that we also have about laws and about how we spend money. So the normal type of political discussions, but we have to engage also politicians in this kind of discussions and the general public, because otherwise we don't get it. We don't demystify the technology within the black box. So we can choose. We either stay with the private stack. At the moment, the internet is almost fully private when it's considered, if you think about the applications layer. There's a lot of open source actually in the stack of the internet, but most of the data and all the services and all the platforms that we use are closed technologies in the hand of private parties, and we are consumer to it, and sometimes we are even the product, as we know. Or we can go, of course, and say, well, then the state can do it. Like the China, a little bit, this is like the easy way to say, well, either the Silicon Valley version or the Chinese version, where the state it owns and has the closed technologies and you're the subject to the state. Or we believe in citizenship and we think that the technology should be a public stack and should be accountable and should be open and should be fair. So this is at the heart of the thinking of that a public stack is possible is that we have to rethink and re-understand what the commons are. The commons are shared resources maintained and or created by communities, organized around commonly defined shared rules. And we know commons as nature is a commons, language is a common, law is a common. So we have a lot of commons, culture is a commons. And a lot of data and technology can be also commons, like open source, open hardware, the Arduino type of technologies. So if we rethink that the commons is possible and we rethink that this is an important element in the technology, we can then build these kind of applications on the basis of the commons. So this could also be an example. This is only one of my last slides about that this is not just happening at the moment in the digital sphere, but also in the life sciences sphere, with our DNA code, our bio, our microorganism code. We have to make this kind of solutions, commons-based solutions, because it's not just our social media, it's also our own biological, our own body and our own embodiment that is going to be privatized. Life is being privatized, is being patented. So this kind of data commons can be used in all kind of different environments, but it can also be used for our own genetic information. So I think if we try to figure out a way out of the mess that we have at the moment, it's clear that we have to start from this rethinking and reclaiming economic models, and rethinking and reclaiming the narrative around technology. Because otherwise we end up just doing a little sort of pushing back on being a bit afraid for the big tech and a little bit there, but we have to have a fundamental reform. And in this fundamental reform, it's not just about the technology, it's about how we deal with the planet. And I think this discussion about commons is at the core of our future. Thank you very much.